What is required to achieve effective wild horse management? I've been thinking about this for a while. I've actually been to 10 out of the last 11 vertebrate pest conferences, and the first one I talked about my PhD work, which was based on trying to solve this problem. Here I am using the latest technology, sand shoes, no socks, no saddle, and no helmet. And my second conference was about management of feral horses in Central Australia, and Mike Brasher, not sure whether Mike's listening, but he came up to me and said, would you like to help write guidelines for managing vertebrate pests, feral horses? So we wrote that. It was the first in a series of documents on managing vertebrate pests. I went to quite a few other conferences, rabbits and horses. Horses are very different to the other pests. And Mike used to tell me it is the impact we need to manage, not the horses. And we argued about this because I said it's very hard to measure the impact. I had done it in Central Australia in 1986 and did okay, but it was very difficult. But anyway, I think Mike's right with horses. You have to measure, you have to manage the impact. It's a very emotional conflict. There is a very emotional conflict between environmentalists and horse protectionists. And if I say something that looks like a horse, they put me in a protectionist box, a horse protectionist box. If I say something the other way about helicopters, they put me in the environmentalist box. Here's a crow fighting himself in a mirror. I think this reminds me of the extreme community groups fighting about feral horses and their management. When one side provokes, the other side responds and gets worse and worse. So if I talk about negative impacts, horse eradication or lethal control, I'm put in an environmentalist box. Alternatively, if I talk about positive ecological impacts or heritage value, I'm put in a protectionist box. It's very tricky, just like gaining the trust of a Brumby for the first time and putting a rope over this fella and he's facing up. That's the first time he's been touched by anyone. Very tricky to work with the community groups with horses. My aim is to remove negative impacts while retaining positive impacts. I'm a feral scientist, and both of me, the environmentalist and horse protectionist, are in that box. I'm chair of the Kosciuszko Wild Horse Scientific Advisory Panel. It's been a really good experience with a really good team of people working very hard to provide scientific advice to prepare a management plan that will effectively manage wild horses in Kosciuszko National Park. Conflict between extreme groups may disrupt or, with their destructive and behaviour could derail this plan. So what's required to achieve effective wild horse management in Kosciuszko? We need to stop this conflict between people with extreme views, reduce distortion of truth, gain trust, show respect, work together. Environmentalists and horse protectionists need a common goal. We need to build a community of interest by listening with respect, which Ted Alter told us this morning. There's plenty of horses in Kosciuszko and they're getting more and more. We really have to do something. We cannot afford to continue to follow the United States. The conflict is forcing us in this direction. They're spending over $80 million a year managing their small population of feral horses, wild horses. Feral futures 2050-2051 ensure our future is as feral free as we can make it. So all we've got to do is change feral horse to wild horse, and that will make, by 2051, there will be no wild horses perishing due to overpopulation, lack of food or water. There will be no negative environmental impact. There will be no impact on the pastoral industry, no impact on vehicles, no dead horses along the side of roads. And we will have fancy technology to get horses to safely cross roads. There are some that do that now. This horse looks to the right. He looks to the left. And then he looks to the right again before saying it's safe to cross, everyone. Very intelligent, these wild horses, feral horses. By 2051, we'll recognise the heritage and aesthetic value of wild horses and have protected these values. We will have measured and enhanced any positive ecological impacts of wild horses. For example, this dung pile has a lot of insects on it, and these little amphibians are eating it. You might notice they're actually cane toads, so we got one feral helping another. But do native species of frogs also benefit from these things? We need to look a bit more closely at this sort of thing. We will have efficiently managed horse density to prevent negative environmental impact while retaining positive impacts, hopefully. Now, this exclosure was built in 1999, and it shows what the difference is between really heavily impacted areas, deer and horses, and no impact. I've been involved in 15 feral horse management programs in Australia. Four of these resulted in complete removal of horses. That's not a very easy thing to do, very, very difficult. I only know of six places where all the horses have been removed in Australia, and I've been involved in four of those. It's not the ideal thing for everywhere, but those places where that was done, that was the ideal thing. You need a solid foundation to actually achieve success, and I've published a list of things that you need to do in this book. These are the foundations. Without the hard work to produce solid foundations, the whole thing will fall over. There's no quick fix. Shortcuts make it more difficult in the future for everyone. These are the list of things we've got to do. Determine distribution and abundance. Define the problem. That's the impact. Identify suitable management techniques, engage the interest groups to decide on management actions, implement agreed actions, assess the value of the management by determining changes in distribution, abundance and reduction in damage. Then you repeat that until it's cooked, until you've got an acceptable level of damage or risk, and you maintain that with the minimum effort or cost. Most people say, well, a lot of people, skip these, just do some marketing, call them introduced heavy, hard-hoofed, invasive ferals. Let's implement actions, don't agree, they won't agree anyway. Let's just go shooting from ground and air. We do that for pigs and deer. And let's forget about these ones. We'll just pretend we succeeded. In New Zealand, they've done a great job. They did detailed ecological work, community involvement, appropriate and effective population control methods. And they read this book. Solid foundation and a very successful thing. Of course, they haven't got a very large population, but they do it really well, the Kiwis. 21 years ago, year 2000, at Guy Fawkes National Park, 606 horses were shot. They implemented the actions, probably a decision they thought was right because there was bushfires and horses might have been going to starve, but they hadn't built the solid foundations, and they hadn't read that book. They told me they hadn't read that book. In that book, there's a whole section on strategic feral horse management, managing the damage, Mike Brasher. And there was a recommendation to develop simple, inexpensive techniques for assessing feral horse density and impact. I've been doing that. Here's in the pine forest where the negative impact is on the road. Magda in her PhD showed us how to estimate the population, the actual number of horses using horse dung density. And we monitor the horses by driving along roads, GPSing where all the dung is, that map there on the left. I just drove 1,000K counting horse dung. We do a kernel analysis and pretty map like this. 4 horse deaths from collisions per year were happening in 2009. We removed all the horses that regularly crossed the road so that for 4 years there were no deaths on the road. But the horse population has expanded and there are more collisions. And by 2026, at 8% per year, they will have filled the whole forest and there will be 3,600 horses. Now let's move down to the Alps, where I've been working also. Been very busy since January. What is required to achieve effective wild horse management? Understanding the relationship between density and impact, very important. And in future, we hope to do experimental manipulation of wild horse density combined with detailed studies of native species population health, so detailed studies of impact on native species. And the Australian Brumby Alliance is actually funding the work that I'm doing. Don't put me in that other box. I'm still a scientist. These horses in the Victorian Alps are very different to Queensland horses. There's a lot of them. In 2011, 12 Robinson and others conducted a broad-scale study of the Alps. They had 186 sites randomly selected, some with horses, some without. Really good study, but they confirmed that sites with horses had impact to horses. Whether the impact is negative or positive and how it varied with horse density was not determined. We've been trying to do that and we've been going back to some of these sites, 47 sites I visited earlier this year, including Quambat Flat, which wasn't one of their sites, but it has exclosures built in 1999, the same as Native Cat Flat. These exclosures, very important sites. And at Native Cat Flat, I walked along a 500-metre transect, here counting impact and dung. 96% of this transect had impact, both deer and horse, hard to tell which was which. And inside the fence, zero impact. Horse dung and deer pellets, 888 piles of horse dung per hectare. Second highest, Quambat Flat was the highest. This is inside the exclosure. That's the creek line inside. The top picture is the creek line outside. Very, very different. See the difference with very high impact and no impact. Now, Bogong High Plain sites, they're all down there near, not significantly different to the exclosure at Native Cat Flat. That's the Bogong High Plains. Those horses are eating the tops off those bits of grass. East Victorian Alp sites, a lot of those below 200 dungs per hectare were also not significantly different to inside the exclosure, but some of them were higher. These were the exclosure sites, massively higher than anything else. This one here had actual domestic horse dung as well and impact. That's that there. And these are the sites with very low impact. So what's this tell us about management? Well, below 200 horse dung per hectare, there seems to be very little impact. These ones, if we target control here and bring them down below 200, people will be able to walk through the bush without seeing much impact. Along the creeks, it's not quite so simple. There's a bit more impact at the lower density, but still most of the sites below 200 had a relatively low impact. Those are the closure sites with the red ring. Oh, here's a critically endangered alpine tree frog. We just noticed, we were wondering why, if there's any frog experts, there were plagues of these critically endangered alpine tree frogs in this dry and clay pan where deer and horse impact was very high, not far from Native Cat Flat. We thought they were grasshoppers at first because we can't see very well, but we got lots of photos and video. And there were broadtooth rat runways at Native Cat Flat. 10 minutes. And there were fresh So there were broadtooth rats there at Native Cat Flat with that massive impact of horses and deer. That's where they were, in this shrub here, hiding from the foxes and dogs, I suppose, and the horses. And the deer wallows, I call them deer wallows. Horses might use them too, but I think they're deer wallows, were full of tadpoles. I quantified this. On the left, the deer wallow, on the right. Could there be some beneficial impact of deer wallows on tadpoles? We've got to do more research on this. Don't put me in the wrong box. I'm just a scientist. I'm interested in this. We need to do better research. We have these 47 sites established, and we can do this better research by manipulating the density, and the management of Parks Victoria will manipulate the density in some areas. We'll be able to measure that. If we can do more detailed studies on the critically endangered species, we will have a better idea of what's going on. What's required to achieve effective wild horse management? Sufficient ecology, far better experimental measurement of environmental impact, reduce conflict between community groups, stop provoking each other and work together, please. Get in the same box. Acceptance of the need to use multiple control tools and monitor performance of management actions and adapt as required. So there you go. Do that and you'll succeed. Thanks very much to everyone who helped with all this work. And that's it.